What's going on, guys? Welcome back to the first official episode of the NFL Universe on YouTube. If you guys have been following us for a minute, we had a podcast over on Apple Podcasts, Spotify. We decided to change things up a bit, you know, include our faces, switch it over to YouTube. With that being said, if you guys don't know about us, we basically discuss NFL news, you know, through the weeks. You know, during the season, we have a little bit more content. Obviously, it's been a little bit drier. We all go to college for the most part or have jobs. So, you know, so we try to cover as much as we can. With the lack of news, we haven't done one. And, you know, we all got caught up doing X, Y, and Z, but we're back. So my name is Nick Horvath. I go to Villanova, big Giants fan. So go Giants. I guess we'll start with Max since he's next on my screen. If you want to introduce yourself real quick.
Yeah, my name is Max and I go to Wake Forest University. And I'm from around the Nashville area, so I'm a pretty big Titans fan.
I guess I'll go next then. What's up, everyone? My name is Matthew. I go to Binghamton University. And even though I'm from New York for my entire life, grew up here, I actually am a big Steelers fan. So, yeah, been that in my entire life and just honestly a big fan of football together, though.
Hey, guys. My name is Alec, and I went to UMass Amherst, and then I got my MBA at Binghamton University. I'm currently working for a sports card company called StarStock. And if you've been listening this whole time, I'm the guy that told you 3 months ago that Kenny Golladay would be a New York Giant. And I'm a Giants fan, and I just saw this coming a while ago. And now I'm happy to spread the word and tell you more of my predictions via YouTube.
Absolutely. So if you guys don't know what he's referring to exactly, a couple weeks, months ago on the podcast, Alec had said Kenny Golladay to the Giants is a sure thing. I don't think there's anybody that really believed him, but damn, he was right. With that being said, our first topic of the day is going to be our favorite team out of free agency. I guess our favorite signing. For me, you know, being a Giants fan, I got to say it might be Kenny Golladay. With the, I would say, you know, constant wheel of receivers the Giants have had over the past couple of years after trading Odell, it's nice to have a star-studded piece like Kenny Golladay on the team. I mean, Darius Slayton has stepped up at times. Sharp's always hurt. Golden Tate hardly played, as well as Tate, you know, being on the age that he is. I think he's 32 now. I know he's at least 31 when the last time he played with the Giants, but, you know, the age and that regression for the type of slot receiver he was, he just wasn't getting the production they needed. Kenny Golladay, you know, offers a lot for this Giants team. Their offensive line played a lot better over this past season. And I think, you know, the return of Saquon Barkley, and I think the Giants have a nice option behind Saquon Barkley at running back. And now their wide receiver core is coming into play. And I think this is all everything that Daniel Jones needs to succeed. And we've seen flashes of him being good, you know, but not consistent enough, right? This is the year I think the Giants have really put a lot together here that their offense can boom as long as Daniel Jones is willing to put in the work and do it. And as well, you know, how his success works out. But, you know, I really like the Giants right here picking up Kenny Golladay. I think it's a great signing. And congrats to Alec on predicting it. I guess I'll go to Max for his favorite signing.
Yeah, so from my team, our big signing was Bud Dupree, the star-studded edge rusher from the Steelers, who unfortunately Matt had to see go. But anyway, this is a signing that we definitely really needed a lot because if you watch Titans last year, I beat the dead horse over this. We just couldn't get to the quarterback at all. And that was one of the biggest reason for our defense being as terrible as it was. So, you know, $16 million is a lot of money for a guy like that, but you know, if you've been looking at next gen stats and stuff like that over the past few weeks, it tells you that the Steelers defense was heavily influenced without Dupree, with and without him. You know, he's a difference maker, and I expect him to do the same in Nashville. I haven't heard this really. Some people might go out and talk about, oh, the Clowney signing didn't work for you guys. I do think Dupree's a much better player than Clowney. I think most people can agree with that. And also, you know, I don't think when you really think about it, and I didn't really realize at the time, Clowney, his strengths really didn't serve, you know, our team what we need to be, because we need a guy that can just get to the quarterback, and Clowney's strengths really allow him to excel best in a run stuffing role, occasionally getting to the quarterback. So I definitely think that's a big difference there as to why Dupree will be a better fit in Tennessee. I also want to talk about the Nico Autry signing, 3 years, I think it was $7.5 million. From the Colts. He's going to play, I assume he's going to play three tech D tackle, which is huge. You know, I really don't even remember when, it's been a while since the Titans also had a guy that can, you know, pass rush up the middle. I think that's what Nico Autry is going to provide. And when you look at this defensive line now of Dupree, Autry, Jeffrey Simmons, and Harold Landry, remember Harold Landry got nine or nine half sacks back in 2019. You know, this is a much improved defensive line, and I think that's definitely where this team is gonna, it all starts getting to the quarterback, and if you can do that, then you can do a lot of other things.
Yeah, I think for myself, really the biggest free agency signing, I feel like I'm gonna go pretty easy here, at least for the first part, is gonna be Dak Prescott. I know that a lot of people weren't like thrilled with this price. I know because he's paid $40 million now. But at the end of the day, you have to pay up for your franchise quarterback. And I remember the days when we had, I'm trying to think of like who else was like the highest paid quarterback for a while. Russell Wilson was, Jared Goff was, I think, for a little bit too. I think Jimmy G was up there too. And now they're like getting paid significantly less than what those top quarterbacks are getting paid now. So obviously the salary is going to keep going up. And the Cowboys have a lot of other problems besides that. But I think that as a Cowboys fan, you have to consider this a win to have your franchise quarterback around for a long time. Really, besides that point, though, I think that just thinking about it from other players that are being signed, I think that the biggest signing is that the defending Super Bowl champions literally bring back their entire roster. I mean, I know we're not going over favorite teams for free agency, but I think that should be a clear win for them. I don't think they have Antonio Brown yet, but I mean, Leonard Fournette, Lavonte David, Shaq Barrett all coming back. It's definitely going to be a huge win for them. And I guess I know this is like favorite free agent signing, but I guess I also kind of want to mention like, I guess some of the ones that I don't really like that much. Like, I mean, like Sammy Watkins to the Ravens. I don't really understand why. Like, I don't really understand. He's still 27, by the way, which I thought Sammy Watkins was way older, but he's only 27, I guess. And I don't really understand the signing for the Ravens. I don't think he's that great. So that's really a big question mark for me for that too. So
yeah, Sammy Watkins was in the same draft class as Odell and Mike Evans, so it is kind of wild to think of it like that. And Sammy Watkins is a horrible fit on that team. I completely agree, especially the fact that he just can't stay healthy, like minor detail. But in terms of the best free agent signing, I mean, I already knew about Kenny Galladay, so it's not even like I was surprised or anything like that. I kind of was also impressed that Dallas just got the job done with signing Dak, because I could have easily seen them mess that up. And I could have seen, oh, you got hurt this year, Dak. You know what? I'm not going to do the right thing here and give you the money that you deserve. Even though that team was fantastic offensively with him on the field, they still couldn't stop anything on the defensive end. So from that perspective, I was really happy seeing that, like in terms of just an owner being loyal to his guy, that type of thing. And also, you just don't want to see Dallas do something really dumb, let him go, and then try to trade up for a quarterback in this draft, something wild like that. Like, I'm just happy that we're not seeing that. And, you know, Kenny Galladay to New York is pretty special. Daniel Jones to Kenny Galladay will be this year's Josh Allen to Stephon Diggs. I don't think that is out of the realm of possibility. I really do not. And it just goes to show you that a lot of people have given up on Daniel Jones in New York. The ownership has not. It is very clear by this move. And it is also very clear that the offense this year, if Saquon comes back healthy, they're going to be a force to be reckoned with. And this draft is huge for the New York Giants.
I will say something. I really thought we were talking about our own teams here, but I also want to comment on two signings that the Browns made. John Johnson from the Rams, and also Troy Hill from the Rams. You know, last year, one of their glaring weaknesses on the field was secondary. A lot of the games, even though at the end of the year they were doing really, really well, Baker was on a roll, their defense was still allowing a lot of points. Even in that playoff game, they got, you know, they still allowed quite a few points and got picked apart in the secondary. Now you add two guys, not necessarily great players, but guys who can bolster your depth there, and then you can potentially do more in the draft to help the defense overall. You know, watch out for the Browns. If they can put the talent all together, you never know. They might become a contender.
I also like to point out how we now, because we can see like all our cameras on YouTube too, we can also see now that Alec has his I believe that's a Giants jersey, right, Alex? You got on right there to celebrate the occasion for Kenny Galladay. But yeah, I mean, I completely agree. Like, I love that signing. I think it's great for the team. I think John Mara or somebody came out and said, like, look, like, we want to, like, win, like, as a Giants organization. We don't want to, like, keep doing this losing thing. So definitely going to be a big year for them. I guess, like, if we're transitioning to, like, more, like, team-based, like, things, I'm talking about, like, teams that I like. Like, I like the Giants, but I always like to think of like the worst stuff too, just because like, I don't know, like guys, like, I don't know if you see any teams that you really think have gotten like, cause I know you have to wait till the draft to see like what exactly a team is going to be built in the upcoming season. Cause the draft is a big part of it. But is there any team right now, like just based on free agency alone, that you think is going to make like a big jump or a big step back? Because my, like, I guess idea of that is like a big step back, I think, is the Raiders. Cause I don't know what the hell they're doing. Like, I don't know why they signed Kenyon Drake. I don't know why they signed John Brown to like when Henry Ruggs, they drafted for that role. I don't know why they got rid of like half their offensive linemen. I don't know why like they did all any of that stuff. I'm curious to see what your guys' thoughts on are, like any like bad or any teams that stand out good or bad, really.
I'm actually going to go right now and talk about the Patriots. So a lot of people were talking about on days one and two, and I'll just mention that they brought in a lot of guys to particularly help out Cam Newton, because
a lot of tight ends.
A lot of tight ends, but their offense really
didn't do the tight ends last year.
But anyway, you know, I want to start with Jonnu Smith because he came from Tennessee. I watched him. I didn't miss him this year at all. And Jonnu, if you're going to get first 4 weeks really was when he was dominating. The first 4 weeks, he's going to be every bit worth that contract, because that in those games, he was absolutely balling out. Just he was one of the primary red zone weapons for Ryan Tannehill. But over the rest of the season, he didn't do nearly as well. And yeah, he was in a lot of, you know, doing a lot of pass blocking because Taylor Lewan was out with his torn ACL. But I can't say I think he's worth $12.5 million per year. Hunter Henry, I do think, is a really good signing. I do think he's one of the best tight ends. I think that one makes a lot of sense. You also got to think about, you know, Kendrick Bourne and Nelson Agholor is the other guy. And I'm not saying what the Patriots are doing, their overall, you know, goal as both their offense. I don't think that's bad at all. I do think that's a good choice. But are Kendrick Bourne and Nelson Agholor game changers? Are they really going to take your offense to another?
No.
Yeah, they're not. They're not going to take your offense to another level. And then Matt Judon, I have a feeling he's going to underwhelm. I don't think he's that kind of terrorizing edge rusher. I don't think he's Dupree's level. I don't think he's anywhere near like a top edge rusher in the league.
Yeah, with that being said, I think we could talk a lot about the teams, but I think it's best if we go through like the top, I don't know how many free agents until we run out of like relevant free agents. But I just going through the list here, provided by CBS. The article was written by, hold on, just want to give proper credit, Cody Benjamin. So there you go. There's a credit there. So just free agent tracking. Yeah, Dak Prescott. We mentioned him. Signed back with the Cowboys. Leonard Williams re-signed with the Giants, which I think is pretty big. Giants need a pass rusher, and I don't think Leonard Williams is incredible, but I think he's the best they're going to get, especially for the sign him for 3 years, $63 million. Godwin returns to the Buccaneers on a franchise tag. Brandon Scherff, 29-year-old guard, returns to the Washington football team on a franchise tag. And then you had Trent Williams return to a 6-year, $138 million contract. Just going through these top five, again, I think we could talk about these top five and then, you know, what teams we can bring up as we go too. But I definitely agree with you, Max, about the Patriots before we even go to them. It just doesn't make a lot of sense to me because I forget who the other two tight ends they were drafted last draft. It was Izzo, and I can't remember the other one. But now
Asiani or whatever?
Yes. So they have like, what, five tight ends on the roster right now? And they have a lot of money tied up in tight ends. And Nelson Agholor, you know, this is the biggest spending spree that Bill Belichick has ever gone on. And it's just, I feel like he's trying to make something out of nothing. I really don't understand, because where the Patriots are in the draft right now, it's a prime spot. They could have got Kyle Pitts from Florida, a good tight end there, and then use their free agency money elsewhere. That was just one thing that I had speculated they might do. But right now, they're not really in a position to replace their quarterback, it seems. They're sticking with Cam Newton. Just a lot of curious moves here. I think, you know.
Which I also don't get a pay raise for Cam.
Yeah, exactly. I don't get that either. He had a pretty abysmal season, and they signed him back. I guess it's just trying to build his confidence, but why shell out money to build his confidence? It's just, you know, Hunter Henry and Jonnu Smith, right? They're both talented football players, both pretty good tight ends in the league. As Max had mentioned, Johnny had a little bit worse of a second half of the season. Hunter Henry was always solid for the Chargers. Not that they're bad players. It's just, are they going to transform this Patriots team? I mean, if Cam Newton can hardly throw the ball, then are your tight ends going to make that big of a difference? I guess they're going to help on that run game and then the short passing game, which is more Cam's strengths. I just don't see the transformation happening, you know? It'd be a lot to really make that jump? And you have all this money tied up in free agents now.
Yeah, I mean, I'll let you guys like kind of, I don't want to like continue this conversation too long, but I just kind of wanted to say that like, I think that the Cam Newton signing like is honestly something that I think was perfectly fine. And honestly, like, I think fair because I mean, his base salary is like a 1.5 mil and he's got like, you know, a signing bonus of 2 mil. So, I mean, he's guaranteed like 3.5 or so. And then all that adds up to 5.5 eventually. Like, it's not like he's honestly getting paid. I think like the same that Marcus Mariota is getting paid as a backup. And like, I mean, like, sure, like you might want to throw a little bit at Marcus Mariota, but you're going to have to pay more, I think, for having somebody that actually is going to, basically, I think that like his salary right now, I think is what it's fine at, you know, like, I think it's just like, it's serviceable and that's really what they want. And if that's all they're going to get, like, that's really it. I mean, you have to keep in mind also he had COVID last year. He also was beat up a little bit early in the year and he had like, I think the best weapon he had was Jacoby Myers, the undrafted free agent wide receiver. N'Keal Harry is not even relevant at all. Has never been, you know, I think that with Hunter Henry, Jonnu Smith, Nelson Agholor, which is already better than N'Keal Harry, and Kendrick Bourne, I think that it might at least show that look like maybe Cam can at least do something more, you know, because at the beginning of the year, he looked fine. Before COVID, he looked fine, honestly. So I think that it's maybe he deserves at least one more chance at it. But then again, they also lost Joe Thuney, so maybe he'll be running for his life now. I don't really know. So
they did bring back Trent Brown, though.
That is true. So I guess in that top five list that I mentioned, Dak, Leonard Williams, Chris Godwin, Brandon Scherff, I always stink with his name, but Trent Williams, you know, is there anything interesting there, you guys? Obviously, the Buccaneers going to Chris Godwin, jumping to Shaquille Barrett, who also got re-signed, 4 years, $72 million. Again, they brought back that core that they won the Super Bowl with, so that's huge. But at the same time, you know, looking at the rest of the list, Trent Williams, the re-sign, that's a lot of money to tie up into a tackle, especially when you're curious on, I don't even know, you know, what we'll get to it a little bit later, but now that they traded up in the draft, are they going to go quarterback? You know, that they've solidified their offensive tackle spot. Do you guys have any comments about that top five list in particular?
Just that I think that Trent Williams, like, also mentioned he was thinking about maybe signing with the Chiefs. And this is something to keep in mind, that I think they realized how serious their issue is in their offensive line. They're trying to fix it. So
thanks, Bill O'Brien, for completely resetting the offensive tackle market by paying Laremy Tunsil $22 million a year last year. That changed everything. So really, I think John Lynch's hands were tied in that scenario. If you want to bring it back and he has offers, you got to do what you can. And Trent Williams, we know, is one of the best offensive tackles in the league. I'm okay with it because you really need to protect your quarterback.
For sure. And with this upcoming draft, it's interesting actually to see different teams who are not going to protect their quarterback based on mock drafts, which based on that alone, like, it was a good signing for Trent Williams. But I was going to talk about Godwin because Godwin's another guy that I'm huge on. Like, he's not exactly at the Kenny Galladay. Like, him and Galladay, I like Godwin a lot. Wasn't a huge factor in the Super Bowl at all. He didn't use, you know, Brady didn't use either one of his big targets in Evans and Godwin. But like you said, Nick, the morale, the chemistry, just bringing back that stud. Godwin, if he's healthy this year, huge year going forward. We got to see what they were able to do, and there's a lot of room going forward for this team, and Godwin's going to excel.
And kind of a segue into what I was going to say, the reason Godwin probably wasn't used much in that Super Bowl is because he didn't have to, because all the Bucs D did was carve up the Chiefs offense, who now have released their two offensive tackles who didn't play in the Super Bowl. And I understand for, I think Schwartz definitely had a pretty bad injury, and I understand getting rid of one guy. You get rid of both your tackles. Yeah. You want Mahomes running for your life, his life again. Like, what are you going to do? And have they done anything to replace him yet?
And now, that being said, I was going to segue into that, going down the list of free agents. You have Allen Robinson, who nobody thought was going to re-sign with the Bears, and they wound up franchise tagging him. Justin Simmons, franchise tagged by the Broncos. Again, a lot of these franchise tags and these re-signings are essentially, these players are crucial parts to their offense/defense, and you know they really need to bring them back. Yeah, Taylor Moten, offensive tackle for the Panthers. He got franchise tagged by the Panthers. And then getting to, I think, Joe Thuney, who I think is probably the biggest person on this list that's next up. We already talked about Hunter Henry. You know, he signs with the Chiefs, right? 5 years, $80 million. He played offensive guard for the Patriots. Can he play tackle? I don't know. Again, as Max had said, I think Chiefs are one of those teams that may regress this year because they went and released both their starting offensive tackles. And I get, because of how your cap space had to work out, that you had to at least release one, but it's hard to release both. You know, I'd probably go with Fisher and leave Schwartz, but at the same time, getting rid of both Fisher and Schwartz, you saw how Mahomes was in the Super Bowl, and now you're getting rid of both. Does Tooney replace them? I personally don't think so. Also, 28, you know, that regression is going to start coming in at some point. I mean, you have him on a five-year deal. When he hits 32, is probably when his maximum regression is going to start coming in. So the Chiefs have him while he's still probably pretty good. But again, I don't think it's enough to replace Schwartz and Fisher. It's just a huge loss. And, you know, signing one player just isn't enough. You know, that goes beyond talent. We're talking chemistry. We're talking how the offensive line is one unit. And when you release two parts of that five-person unit, you know, that's nearly half the unit. That's a huge
loss. Most important parts of the offensive line.
Mm-hmm. Do you guys have any comments about
decision? It was a baffling decision, especially the whole world watching the most talented athlete right now having to throw while he's parallel to the ground, running away from people. How do you do this? I don't understand it at all. And I'm quite frankly confused because, like you said, they could have easily just kept one of them. Why did they do this? I don't know. Like, what do they have up their sleeve? I'm really curious. But quick aside, Allen Robinson must be the most sad multimillionaire ever. Okay, to go back to this atrocious team that has no quarterback, I'm sick of it. Allen Robinson, he should have been in New York too, honestly. Like, I wasn't predicting that. I knew Kenny Galladay was coming, but my God, Allen Robinson deserves better. He really does.
One other thing about this podcast, if you've been watching for the past few months, you can tell how much Alec hates the Bears. I don't hate the Bears quite as much as Alec, but you rightfully honestly, so. Let's just say that.
I think it's a fair, honestly, for me, it's more of a, I guess, like, kind of like a pity. I don't know. Like, it's kind of like that thing where you're like, oh, like that's like just classic Bears. And it's just like kind of what you got to accept at this point, you know?
I also did see Allen Robinson liking tweets that were anti-franchise tag. So you know he's not happy.
100%. He was very clear that he wanted out of there and they still brought him back. You know, it's just, and it's like whatever quarterback you eventually settle on in Chicago, your star receiver is not happy. And it's just, it's not a good combo, you know, at that point. It's best to let him go, and you know, it hurts the locker room, especially if Al Robinson is going to come with the attitude that this franchise stinks. I'm not going to try my hardest, you know.
Andy Dalton's the best quarterback that Allen Robinson ever got. Just saying.
And it's also a bad business move, I think, as you touched on, Nick, because it's like, okay, you want a franchise tag him, then trade him. Well, you know, he doesn't want to play for you anymore, so that his value is already to the floor. Like, what are you doing?
At that point, you just got to let him walk. So. Moving forward down the list, Marcus Williams franchise tags the Saints. Levante David, again, talking about the Buccaneers bringing back that core. 2 years, $25 million. And I forget who had mentioned it before, but Levante David, obviously a huge part of that defense. He's, you know, eventually the leader of that defense and huge part of why their linebacker core was so successful, you know, apart from Devin White and his spectacular play, especially in the postseason. So, yeah, bringing him back was huge. I think it's a little more fun to talk about the players that change teams. Run right here. Corey Lindsey, center for the Packers. He goes to the Chargers, 5 years, $62.5 million. I think Lindsey's a really good center. I'm not sure how this affects the Chargers. I think it's good for the Chargers because you need to protect Justin Herbert, but I think, you know, offensive tackle is the most important part. But again, Lindsey, you know, he's the type of player that could help transform that offensive line and just continue to solidify them protecting Herbert. I mean, Herbert, great first season, obviously. So without a doubt, I like the signing. I just don't know if it's going to be the be-all, end-all solution to, you know, solidifying their offensive line. But, again, I like the signing. Warren Lindsey's a good center. He is 29 years old, so, again, that regression will hit at some point. But hopefully you get, you know, on a five-year contract, 29 years old, you get enough out of him that you'll be able to replace him by the time Herbert's in his prime, you know. So that's my thinking there. I guess start with Max.
I definitely do like that signing. I think, you know, even – you overpaid a little bit for a center. I mean, you do need to protect your quarterback, and that's definitely the precedent they're setting. I've thought all along they're definitely going to take offensive line in the draft, and they're a team that can play long game because how young their quarterback is. So I like moving. I think I'm going to give them a chance to, you know, keep improving on what they've done.
I hate seeing young quarterbacks without any protection. That's the thing that bothers me the most. When you're building a franchise – and then year after year, different GMs, different coaches, different front offices see Deshaun Watson go down in one of his early years. Joe Burrow go down in his rookie year. This has to, like, make everyone's eyes look at how you build a team. How do you do it? And listen, like you said, Max, they probably overpaid a little, but Cincinnati in this upcoming draft, they need to make sure they take care of Joe Burrow. I think the Giants should be taking care of Daniel Jones. I really do, because all of these quarterbacks, the team, the franchise, everything is in jeopardy if you don't make sure that that offensive line is in check.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't have much thoughts myself because you guys kind of all like hit it on the nail. I mean, for me personally, I mean, honestly, I'm not really like too knowledgeable on like the inner workings of offensive lines, on like what will actually like work when compared to other players. But I do know, and I agree with Alec and Max here, when it's like you kind of just have to at least like try. You know, at least like it might be an overpay, but at least like try to fix it, you know, with bringing in better players. So, I mean, you know, it can't hurt, you know, at least the attempt is to try something to get better players there. So,
with that being said, moving on to the next set of free agents, you had John Johnson, as I think it was Max had mentioned, was with the Rams, is now with the Browns, 3 years, $33.75 million. You know, I think they overpaid a little bit there, but I think John Johnson is still a good player. You know, after Grant Delpit went down last year, they're definitely looking to, you know, have that backup, backup player at safety, sort of starter. I mean, John Johnson, you know, where they're going to fit him in. Either way, I think he's a very versatile player. So, you know, adding him to that talented defensive roster is definitely a big win. Carl Lawson signs with the Jets. I think he's a solid pass rusher, 3 years, $45 million, and that's the premium you pay in free agency for a pass rusher. Don't know if he's going to change their defense and how abysmal that Jets team is, but yeah, you know, Curtis Samuel signs with the Washington football team for 3 years, $35.5 million. Returns to his former coach in Ron Rivera. Should be interesting there. Do you guys have any comments on those three?
Yeah, I'll get into one thing. It won't be saying much, but the NFC East will not be the worst division this year. And I'm saying that just because I like what Ron Rivera is doing in Washington. I think Washington is at least 8-8, and I think that they honestly could be a 10-6 type of team. I like Dallas coming back this year if Dak is healthy. And I'm not ruling out Jalen Hurts leading the Eagles to a nice year. So I'm actually excited about the NFC East this year. Obviously, they sucked as a whole last year, but a lot of positive things at the beginning of this offseason for that division.
William Jackson signs Washington as well, 3 years, $42 million, corner from the Bengals. Not huge fan of William Jackson. I think he's a decent corner, but I don't think he's, again, not going to transform a franchise. Romeo Okwara re-signs with the Lions, 3 years, $39 million. Me and Max are just joking about it. Why would you want to re-sign with the Detroit Lions in your prime? Why would you waste your years with that doomed franchise? And then I think here's a good spot for me, I think, to stop. Again, if you guys have any comments about previous signings, go ahead and say so. Aaron Jones re-signs with the Packers, 4 years, $48 million. Obviously, for Jones, this is a great re-signing, right? You're getting paid decent money. And then additionally, right, you're with the Packers, who are in position to win a championship. With that being said, I really didn't expect the Packers to re-sign Jones. I figured they'd stick with Williams, who's the cheaper option, and really, you know, spend that money elsewhere. But they decided to stick with Jones, and I think it's confident. It's saying, we have confidence in you. You're a really talented running back. I think there's no doubt about Aaron Jones' his talent, right? We see him at least a couple times a season really explode and put up incredible fantasy numbers, if not performances on the football field. So, you know, I think it's a decent signing. I just thought they were going to go with the cheaper option of Williams. What do you guys have to say about those couple of free agent signings?
Honestly, like, this isn't even like a Williams thing, because it's more of like an A.J. Dillon thing. Because, like, A.J. Dillon's, like, more built like Aaron Jones. But don't even – I mean, like, they're going to let him walk anyway. But, like, but don't even get me started on this, because, like, it's – I mean, it's good for the team and everything, but it just – It makes sense for them, but it still makes their last draft make literally no sense.
Like, that's why I totally forgot about AJ Dillon, who's same build as Jones.
But that's my point, though. Like, is that you forgot about AJ Dillon because everybody forgets about that draft. Like, it's literally AJ Dillon and Jordan Love were the first two picks. Like, I guess, well, Jordan Love won, and then AJ Dillon the second round. And neither of them are going to see the field until their contracts end up. Like end pretty much. I mean, AJ Dillon probably will before Jordan Love. So I just doesn't make sense why they did that. You know, like, they could have taken a T. Higgins, like, they could have taken somebody else later in that first round, and they could have, you know, had that maybe for this NFC Championship run. You know, they could have taken anybody. I don't really know. I don't remember much of the players in that area, but it certainly would have been better than having a backup running back and a backup quarterback. Like, the whole point of drafting a quarterback is like in the first round is that you get that 5-year window, right? Where you can like, okay, like we're going to have a rookie like contract. We're going to make a run. And now like Jordan Love's going to be on his second contract without even having like played a snap most likely. So I don't really understand it at all. And I'm just really curious to see why the Packers, like, I just want to know like 100, like I wish whoever, I think it's Ted Thompson still, whoever, like whoever the GM is for the Packers. I just hope that I could one day get a truth theorem and just like ask him, like, why did you do this? Like, I don't know why at all.
All right. I'm not a conspiracist, but conspiracy theory time right now. So every move the Packers made from the draft on had one purpose in mind: to piss off Aaron Rodgers so much he just takes it on the field. That was it. And the more they can exacerbate the fact that last draft makes no sense, they can piss him off even more, and he'll put up MVP numbers again, and it'll be incredible. That's the best their organization can do, and it worked already, so do it again.
Yeah, this is the Packers being the Packers, as far as I'm concerned. Like, it's just another head-scratcher, because I like Aaron Jones a lot, actually. But I think he would do so much better on another team to begin with. And besides that, from the Packers' perspective, why give this huge contract? You have two running backs that are both viable options. Like, it's not like they're just random dudes. They're both viable running backs in the National Football League at a premium price, like such a discount compared to what they just paid for Jones. And we've seen on a per-touch basis, Williams put up nice amount of numbers. So if Dylan isn't ready for the full load yet, Williams could take it on. And I just don't get it, because we talked about in the last draft how they should have gotten a wide receiver or a tight end of some nature to help out Rodgers. Here, it was like you could have had an extra nearly $50 million that you could have allocated to either help your defense, help your line, or get another guy for Aaron Rodgers. Jones isn't pivotal to the team's offense. He wasn't the entire year. That was kind of the move by bringing in LaFleur, was like, okay, now it's Rodgers' time to shine. So bringing back Jones, I don't get it. One bit. I really don't.
No disrespect to Jones, though. I just want to say that, like, the dude literally, I think at points, has done a fantastic job in Green Bay. I just think from a monetary standpoint, just from like a previous draft standpoint, it makes no sense. Like, if you thought, and these GMs, right, are thinking like more than a year out. Like, if you're thinking more than a year out, you should be like, okay, like, we know Aaron Jones' contract's coming up next year, and we're going to re-sign him, so we're not going to take his backup this year. Or you could have said, we're not going to sign him, and we should take a backup. Like, they did kind of both. They were like, okay, we don't really know what we're going to do, so we're just going to take a backup and try to re-sign him. Like, I don't know what the point was putting more money into that position. So
I guess moving on from there, getting ourselves off the Packers, moving forward, you have Bud Dupree, which you already talked about, signs with the Titans. Max had covered that pretty well. Anthony Harris, Vikings to the Eagles on a 1-year, $5 million contract. You know, I think it's kind of interesting. Eagles definitely need help in the secondary, and I think Anthony Harris is a solid safety to do so. Only on a 1-year contract, though, you know, I'm not sure what they want to get out of him there. He is 29, so I guess they're trying to avoid regression, you know, and only sign him for that amount of time to see how he does in that 1 year. Melvin Ingram, still unsigned, coming off the Chargers, 31 years old. You know, still, I think, a decent edge rusher, linebacker. It's be interesting to see where he goes when it's all said and done. Trey Hendrickson goes from the Saints to the Bengals on a 4-year, $60 million contract again. I think yet another example of a decent pass rusher. Team needs a pass rush. They'll pay premium money in free agency to go out and get one, and that's Trey Hendrickson. Not saying Trey Hendrickson's a bad player, right? It's you know, solid pass rusher for the Saints. Don't get me wrong. Just, I don't know if he's considered one of the elite pass rushers, and you have to pay a premium to get even a mid-tier to a good pass rusher in free agency. Moving on from there, we had Corey Davis.
I want to say a little bit something about the Trey Hendrickson signing, because I think honestly he's a huge wild card, because I think what did he put up, like 13 sacks or something like that? What was the exact number? Does anyone know? It was somewhere in that ballpark. We'll just go with that.
And I remember we talked about it. Yeah.
Yeah. So it was a pretty high number. But how much of it was it due to being on a team with Marcus Davenport and Cam Jordan?
He had 13 and a half this past season.
Yeah, how will he do as the guy? That I'm really curious to see. Because
yeah, he had 4.5 the season before, and then 0, and then 2 in the first season. So definitely stats have taken he had 13.5 out of his 20 career sacks this season. So
the Bengals are really, you know, betting on the fact that he's going to continue this progression. But now you switch his team. You've taken Cameron Jordan out of the equation. So there's a lot of moving pieces there. As Max said, big wild card there. And again, 13 and a half sacks, good pass rusher. Don't get me wrong. The fact that he's continuing to improve is a good sign, but pay me a premium dollar for somebody like that. I wouldn't be comfortable with that as a GM. Moving on from there, again, if you guys have any comments about anyone, just feel free to stop me. Corey Davis signs from the Titans. He goes to the Jets on a 3-year, $37.5 million contract. I talked about this in our group chat. I think it's a fantastic signing for the Jets. Tough loss for the Titans, but, the Titans needed to cut cap somewhere. And Corey Davis was that guy. Corey Davis obviously wants to be option one at receiver, not behind A.J. Brown. And the Jets absolutely offer him that position. With that being said, I think Corey Davis's numbers are going to go up, right? Whoever the quarterback winds up being with the Jets, he's going to be the number one target. Their wide receiver core behind him is very thin, to say the least. I think Denzel Mims offers potential. But to say he's a shoe-in as a good receiver is a stretch. And then you have, again, a lot of spotty players. So I think Corey Davis is clearly their clear number one right off the rip. I think it's a really good signing for the Jets. I think he's a really talented player. Wouldn't be surprised if he finishes his next season with something around 1,500 yards and 10 touchdowns. That's the usage that they're going to get out of Corey Davis, I think, the Jets. I'm sure, Max, you have some comments.
I like Corey Davis a lot. I definitely don't think at least what he proved on the Titans, he's definitely not your number one receiver. A.J. Brown was definitely the better player, definitely a better red zone target, definitely better do everything kind of player than Corey Davis. It's tough to see him go. But the question I really have is, how did he get that much money? Because on the second day of free agency, all we kept hearing about was free agency, the market for receivers is so bad right now. And Juju Smith-Schuster, who we might talk about later down this list, he was forced to take a one-year re-sign deal. And Corey Davis is out here getting $13 million for one good season? What? I don't get it.
I completely agree with you. I don't – the 1,500 yards and 10 touchdowns, Nick, what a prediction. We'll hold you to that one. I don't see that at all. I mean, Corey Davis, nice player, nice piece. Anybody that goes to the Jets, I already have a question mark and like a little head scratch of like, all right, let's see what happens. But the money was the biggest thing, Max. I was like, okay, he'll go somewhere so he's the number one. That makes sense. The money that this guy got was unreal. And it wasn't like the theme that we were seeing of, okay, you need to pay premium dollar to protect your quarterback. You need premium dollar as an edge rush. The Jets, they could have went after different guys, not a Galladay, or a Godwin, but they could have went after an Aguilar that would have made a nice piece or someone like that. That's not Corey Davis, obviously. But the money for Corey Davis, I'm curious what other teams offered him a huge contract, in all honesty, because it was a bizarre contract.
I remember when I first heard about that signing, my initial reaction was, so we lost out the $13 million to the Jets. I thought he was going to get more than that. Then when I saw how bad the market really was, my thought is now, he got that much money? What? Yeah, it was.
He's also 26, just so you guys know. I mean, like, I don't get to talk about this because Juju Smith-Schuster is, like, right after him on this list. Like, so Juju's 24 and got $8 million and for 1 year. And Corey Davis is 26 and got 3 years for, like, 12 and a half per year. So
yeah, and my prediction with Corey Davis is a function of the Jets' offense and how much they're going to rely on him. It's not exactly – Corey Davis, again, talented wide receiver, but I don't think he's really a 1,500-yard, 10-touchdown receiver consistently year after year. It's just the fact they're going to try and force him the ball. Similar to, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, with the white short receiver that the Jets pretty much spammed the ball to all year.
Braxton Perrios?
Yes, there you go, Perrios. They forced the ball to Perrios, I don't know how many times, and I wouldn't be surprised if they go and do that again, out of desperation, because their offensive line is still, beyond Becton. You're still looking at a lot of missing pieces for their offensive line. Wide receiver core is not there, running backs are spotty as could be. You lost Le'Veon Bell, so that offense is a mess beyond the fact that you still don't have a franchise quarterback that's set.
Yeah, literally. You brought the whole piece of, like, the quarterback. It's like, all right,
yeah. So it's just, you know, a lot of missing pieces there. And I feel like Corey Davis is going to, they're going to, Jets are going to rely, I think, a lot on Corey Davis, especially with the fact that all this money they spent on him in terms of this free agency, that they're going to try and force him the ball a lot. So that's where
let's also not forget the fact that, you know, until this year, a lot of people had Corey Davis labeled as a bust. I was definitely part of that too, because he had,
because he was.
That's literally what it is. He wasn't doing anything for like his first 2 years. I think that once AJ Brown comes in, it gets much better. So does that tell you what you need to know? I mean, we'll see, but
yeah, if I was the Jets, I would have offered that contract right to Aaron Jones. I mean, that would have been my type of thing. Like, I don't see why Corey Davis is going to put them so much better than if they had given a contract like that to Aaron Jones, in all honesty. Because this is a team that could have easily found a scrappy receiver here and there to match up with their potentially new quarterback, whoever that may be. While the running game has, what is it? The whole offense is down to nothing, but even into the season, it's a huge question mark, that running game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I kind of want to drive this conversation more towards the Juju Smith-Schuster, which I'm sure Nick was going to do too, because it's like the next pickup where he's like 1 year. I believe it was 1 year.
1 year, $8 million.
For the Steelers. And so, like, this is kind of like my question for you guys, which I feel like we've got a consensus here based on what I heard about Corey Davis. Would you rather have Juju Smith-Schuster at 24 playing for you for 3 years, $37.5 million, or would you rather have Corey Davis 26, 3 years, $37.5 million? Because I mean, personally, Juju, just so you guys know, Juju's best offer on the market was $9 million from the Ravens plus $4 million in incentives, and the Chiefs gave the same exact offer that the Steelers did. So, I mean, like, I'm sure, like, even $10 million, or maybe, like, I don't know, like a $10 million 3 years might have gotten the job done for Juju. I don't know, but that's how I felt. Maybe.
I mean, my thing is, why are the Steelers offering Juju 1 year? You know, I think it's because of how the cap's going to work out, and the fact they're trying to bring back Big Ben for this next year, and they want to keep that the contract's even. You know, Big Ben 1 year, and then because Big Ben presumably is gone after this next year. I don't think he should bring him back at all, but he's coming back. So, you know, try to match the contract. But
yeah,
I'd definitely go long term with Juju.
Yeah, I think it's honestly more of like, for as a Steelers fan, I kind of like know a little bit about this. I think it's more just because of the fact that the market is so like dry and the cap coming down. They just want to have a 1 year deal to see what he's doing. Because honestly, I mean, Juju, I think gets way too much hate. I think what the Steelers did last year was, I mean, okay, well, let's, social media aside, I mean, like just on the football field wise, I think he gets too much hate, because like, it seems to me like at least last year, the Steelers were doing a very heavy short game thing, and Juju, like, his stats were down, yeah, but like, that was kind of what he was told to do. Like, he was supposed to be like that over the field kind of guy catching the 5 yard passes from Big Ben, who was basically 2015 Manning. So I mean, like, that's just kind of like what his job was. Like, he wasn't expected to be going out there and catching all these deep passes, because, and honestly, Big Ben wasn't really throwing these deep passes. I mean, like, there's some games where he'd like revitalize his arm like Frankenstein, but then he just like fall apart the next game. So I mean, I just think that if I was the Jets, I mean, I'm happy as a Steelers fan that he's back. I think that he's 24. I think there's plenty of room to grow. And I think that honestly, if I was the Jets, I would have preferred to at least sign him instead of it, even like for like 2 years and like $11 million each. Like, you've got the money, like at least like try to sign someone like him too. Because I mean, he has potential. I mean, like, you saw him, and like, I know Antonio Brown's on the side, but he has some potential. So I think being so young too, 2 years younger, could definitely play a role.
I actually was going to talk about Juju. I definitely do think he hampered his value with all of his social media antics, because, you know, the way he was, I think, honestly, if you were to say he didn't put a target on the team's back by doing what he did, I think you'd be wrong. I definitely think the other teams took out their anger on him. And he also didn't even stop him before the playoff game. Didn't he mock the Browns too or something like that?
He stopped before that, honestly. And I think it's like a different conversation we could have, but like, I think that it wasn't really as much a market. I don't think it really affected market value. I think what really affected market value was the fact that he stunk up the last year, and he showed that he couldn't do better with a bad quarterback. And then this year he also had poor stats, but I think that was like more misleading. He stopped like, I think like 2 games before like the end of the season, but I don't think it really affected market value. Just nobody wants wide receivers. I mean, like, Galladay's the only one that I think like, and I think Curtis Samuel's really gotten the big, and Corey Davis have gotten like the top three deals, I feel like, right? I don't remember anybody else, but.
Matt, to answer your seemingly ludicrous question from my perspective, I would definitely want Juju over Corey Davis. And I would.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I would hope that Corey Davis proves me wrong, because I don't like rooting against anybody to begin with. But I think all this showed us was Juju had a mediocre year with a horrible quarterback. With a league average quarterback, Juju's a top 15 wide receiver. I think it's really that simple. And if he has a decent to stellar quarterback, wow, Juju is back to the guy that we saw 2 years ago. He'll be a top 8 receiver, something in that ballpark. I mean, the talent is there. He's 24 years old. If both of these guys are healthy, I'm definitely taking Juju over Corey Davis. And from the Steelers' perspective, I completely agree with you, Nick. One-year deal doesn't make sense to me. Because right now, Juju is going to look at this 1 year as payday. If he balls out, all of a sudden, they need to pay him significantly more than they would have if they gave him a Corey Davis-esque deal just now.
And that comes off of him, not this past season where he had 9 touchdowns. I forget, it was like 600 yards or whatever it was that he had. But, you know, the year prior, his past 2 years, he's looking at, I forget how many yards he had. It was like 600, and then he only had like 3 touchdowns. You know, if he returns to that level of play, if not even continues to grow where he had in his first 2 seasons where you have 1,000 yards, 7 touchdowns, you know, that you're going to have to pay premium dollar for him, as you just mentioned. Not a good move if he plays as good as he can. They're going to have to pay more for him to hold on to him. And
yeah, also keep in mind that the cap is also, like, really hard for the Steelers right now. Like, yeah, I mean, I've been watching it for a little bit, and it's just, like, that's why people thought he wasn't going to come back just because of the cap. And also just reference, he to 2018 actually, he does breakout year, 111 receptions, 1400 yards, and 7 touchdowns. Next year, 42 receptions, 550 yards, 3 touchdowns, and then last year was almost 100 receptions, 830 yards, and 9 touchdowns. Just, you know, take with that whatever you want. So
yeah, so he's productive. He's relatively consistent. He had a bad year at one point, but again, relatively consistent, productive. And he's only 24, you know, and there's a ton of room for him to grow, especially when he gets a quarterback that can actually throw the ball. In my opinion, you lock him in long term, but we already discussed that. So going on from there, Matt Milano re-signs with the Bills, 4 years, $44 million. I think it's a pretty good signing for them, you know, a little bit overpaid. I don't think Matt Milano is that talented, but he is a very crucial part to that defense. You know, he's their coverage linebacker. He kind of plays a linebacker slash safety role for them. Very important for that defense. Bringing him back is important. So I understand where the money's going there. Alejandro Villanueva, still unsigned from the Steelers. Great player. I think a great person. Alejandro Villanueva, he served in the military, but 32 years old, probably regressing. Teams are not going to want to pay top dollar for him. I understand it. Hassan Reddick signs with the Panthers on a 1 year, $8 million deal. Had a solid year with the Cardinals, to say the least. Was it this year or was it the year prior? I can't remember. Did he have like 5 sacks in one game? Was that Reddick? Yeah. So obviously he has the ability to explode. Not really sure how it helps the Panthers in their situation right now, especially in a one-year deal, but interesting there. Marcus May, franchise tag by the Jets, really solid safety, probably the best defensive player they have, give or take, right now. So I definitely see why they franchise tagged him. Matt Judon, as we discussed, went 4 years, $56 million to the Patriots. Not necessarily going to turn that defense over, but again, edge rusher who's decent, gets paid premium dollars in free agency. Guaranteed equation pretty much every year. Darryl Williams, offensive tackle, returns to the Bills on a 3-year, $28 million deal. Guys, go ahead and stop me whenever you're ready. Shaquille Griffin, Seahawks, goes to the Jaguars, 3 years, $40 million. You know, I think Shaquille Griffin's a really good corner. Kind of sad to see him go off the Seahawks, but definitely had to go get paid with the Jaguars, so I understand the decision there. I think he's a really solid corner, and you know, he's definitely a corner that can compete for sure, for one of the better corners in the league. I wouldn't say he's elite, but definitely one of the better corners in the league. So I think the Jaguars got a good player there. $40 million over 3 years, a little bit probably too much in terms of paying for a corner that's not elite, but no, either way, good player. Gronkowski re-signs with the Buccaneers, 1 year, $10 million deal. I overpaid him a bit, but you want to keep Gronk in that Brady connection. I understand where the money's going. 1 year is pretty solid because we don't know how long Brady's going to last. Rob Gronkowski is prone to getting injuries. There's a lot of iffy factors there that I see why they only hold him down to 1 year contract. Makes sense to me. Patrick Peterson, here's a big one. 1 year, $10 million deal with the Vikings. We've seen Pat Pete, you know, as great of a corner he's been, in the league. You know, I probably say the best corner in the league for probably 2 to 3 year span. We've seen the regression that he's had. It seems I see why the Cardinals are moving off of him. Right, you have Byron Murphy, who's been really solid, as well as you're having Isaiah Simmons come up. You know, you have a lot of good players. Buda Baker is pretty good. So you want to use the guys that you have, and with how much Patrick Peterson's regressing, it just wasn't worth the money for them to bring him back on and pay him the money that they would have had to keep him. So I see why they let him walk there. Do you guys have any comments so far?
The Vikings, why? I love Patrick Peterson, and the regression has been so bad. It's so tough to watch him. He gets wrecked constantly. And the Vikings probably have two of top 20 wide receivers in the league. So in practice, he is going to get wrecked. And that's going to destroy, like, whatever confidence he currently has is because of who he was 5-6 years ago. He's not the player he was. 1 year, $10 million for Patrick Peterson is a Hail Mary of all Hail Marys. Like, what are they hoping for? I don't know.
Yeah, for them, you know, their secondary was all terrible. Their whole defense is really bad, but they need a permanent fix, one for like a guy for years. They could have waited for Kyle Fuller to be released and sign him. I think that would have been a better option, but no, they take a guy who's cooked. And yeah, I bet he's going to be cooked in practice by Justin Jefferson all the time.
I mean, he's 30 years old. Again, that regression is hitting him very hard. We've seen it. And as you guys said, tying $10 million into him over this year is not going to – it's not going to solve anything for them. It's a Band-Aid to a gaping wound.
Yeah, Fuller is 29 years old. We haven't seen regression. Maybe a little bit. He had a very good year last year, Kyle Fuller. So in terms of where you want to put your money, it was obviously Fuller over Patrick Peterson. And Patrick Peterson getting this deal, I mean, God bless him, run to the bank. I mean, he doesn't deserve any of that. And you know, Kyle Fuller now in Denver, you know, they keep on doing things where I'm just like, whatever you do, it doesn't really matter to me because Drew Lock needs to prove himself. So like, that's over my head kind of.
Yeah. I was actually going to talk about that too. I do really like the Kyle Fuller signing for the Broncos. I think a lot of people don't really talk about how good of a defense they have. You know, with AJ Boye being a free agent, you know, they needed definitely reinforcements back there, and they got that Kyle Fuller. I had them taking a corner in the draft, probably a Caleb Farley or what's the other guy? Patrick Surtain. Definitely one of those guys. Maybe not so much anymore, but you know, people forget about, you know, how good the Broncos defense is because they can't score. But yeah, I guess that's not going to help them score any more points.
So moving on from there, Dalvin Thompson, longtime backup, pretty much nose tackle, defensive tackle for the Giants, goes to the Vikings on a 2-year, $22 million deal. I like this move a lot better for the Vikings. I think Dalvin Thompson's a good player. I think the Giants just really didn't need Tomlinson, right? We have Big Dex, Dexter Lawrence in the middle. We have B.J. Hill, who I think is a really good guy for depth, right? Not a typical starter. We don't really have the room for Tomlinson. We kind of had to let him walk with the cap and us re-signing Williams. So I think he's going to be a good piece for the Vikings. You know, I think that's a good signing for their defense in terms of a little bit more long-term. It's only 2 years. You know, they might re-sign him afterwards. He is 27. I think this is a better signing than Patrick Peterson for sure. Alex, you have any comments about that as you are a Giants fan?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, we're able to let him go. And in terms of it being a better signing than Patrick Peterson, I mean, anything. I really was one of those signings that I was like, Patrick Peterson was one of my favorite players growing up. I have a Patrick Peterson shirt upstairs. I really enjoyed watching him play and shut down people. So, you know, the Vikings, you win some, which they did, and they lost this one in Patrick Peterson, unless he has type of revival that I am not predicting.
Yeah. And then going on from there, Yannick Ngakoue signs to the Raiders. Pretty solid edge rusher. He's got passed around for quite a few teams. Vikings to the Ravens, and now he's on the Raiders. 2 years, $26 million, $13 million a year. Not incredible in terms of the amount of money they had to pay for him. So I think he's a good pass rusher for the price. Not sure how it affects the Raiders long term there. Will Fuller goes to the Dolphins on a one-year deal. Always injury-ridden. Trying to get off the Texans. I'm sure nobody wants to return to the Texans as soon as they get away from that whole situation. We didn't even talk about it, but with Deshaun Watson, him wanting out, not only that, but all these cases and the accusations that are piling up against him, that Bill O'Brien left. It's just nobody wants to go back to the Texans, and I'm sure Fuller wanted to get out of there too. You know, especially with his PED use. That's what he got suspended for, right? I can't remember exactly what it was. It was a 4-game suspension for PED use. Yeah.
He has to serve one game this year, so he'll miss week one.
Dude is electric as they come, though. I'll tell you that. Literally, it's so much fun to watch him play, but the dude just keeps getting injured or suspended. Come on, Will.
I think he'll definitely help out Tua going into this year, too. So it'll be fun to see how him and Will Fuller make a connection. If they do, Will Fuller will be 27 at that point. Don't be surprised if the Dolphins want to sign him for an extra 4 or 5 years at that point, whatever it might be, locking him in a little bit more long-term if he could stay healthy and be productive. Remember from there, James Winston re-signs with the Saints on a 1-year, $12 million deal. It's going to be between him and Taysom Hill at this point, unless they go to the draft and get a quarterback. I don't know. Have the Saints officially released who the starting quarterback is? Because obviously Drew Brees retired, so I haven't kept up to date with that. Are they officially signing a quarterback? They are not, according to Max, so I'm going to believe Max.
I have no idea, and they should, because I don't think either of those guys are good.
I definitely agree. So it's going to be interesting to see what they do there, but they bring back James Winston. Lynn Floyd, who was solid for the Rams last year, signs 4-year, $64 million deal. Again, good, decent part of the Rams defense last year was really dominant. Bring him back for a premium price, because that's what you got to do in the free agency with edge rushers. Jadeveon Clowney, still unsigned.
I also want to talk about Leonard Floyd here. You know, as good as he was last year, how much of that's influenced by him playing next to Aaron Donald and Michael Brocker? Like, is he worth $14 million a year for that 1 year?
Yeah, you're very right there. I definitely agree.
We'll see. And now Michael Brock is gone, so they'll have to do more.
No. You better hope that you chose the right player, basically.
Right.
So moving on from there, Xavier Rhodes re-signs with the Colts, 1 year, $6.5 million deal. Still a decent corner, just nothing like he used to be with the Vikings. Decent money there, nothing spectacular. I think the Colts have him in with a pretty good deal there. Eric Wilson still unsigned from the Vikings. Mentioned Sammy Watkins to the Ravens. I think I spoke about it before. I definitely agree. I don't think he's anywhere near a solution for the Ravens that they need at wide receiver. We have Austin Reiter, center for the Chiefs, still unsigned. Kevin King re-signed with the Packers, which I think was an easy signing for them. They needed him back. Kenyon Drake to the Raiders, we talked about. Troy Hill to the Browns. T.Y. Hilton goes back to the Colts on a 1-year, $10 million deal. 31 years old, regressing a little bit. Max, you have something to say?
Yeah, you also missed Jayon Brown back to the Titans 1 year at $5.25 million. I want to talk a little bit about that. You know, with everything, the way free agency was looking at the beginning before everything happened, it looked like definitely he was going to walk. I really like we brought him back at that price, because he's kind of like, as Matt talked about several episodes back with Levante, David being the captain of the Bucks defense. Jayon Brown is tells the defense. He's kind of has the same role for the Titans, and to bring him back that cheap, you know, I don't think he's as good as I don't think he'll be quite as good as he was in 2018. But he's definitely one of the defense's best players and a really good linebacker. I'm glad we got him at that cheap rate.
Mm-hmm. And to be honest, we keep going, and Matt had texted the group. You know, we can keep going down this list, but I think we went through the top 50 that CBS has listed. I guess with that being said, we'll end the podcast here. Don't want to make it too long. You know, leave comments down below, guys, what you guys want to see. If you guys want us to keep going through free agents, we can keep going through the list. We come back next week, cover a couple notable names, and then go into the draft, because that is our plan for next week. We're going to cover the draft, especially the trades that happened, a little bit of a mock, see what we got going on there. You know, the draft's right around the corner now, so it's going to be interesting. I hope you guys enjoyed the first podcast. Do you guys have any final words?
No, just really excited to see this draft, because I'm really excited to have this conversation about Wilson and Field eventually. So
The draft is in 29 days. I can't wait.
See you guys next time. This was a great first podcast, guys.
100%. So again, if you guys enjoyed the content, definitely subscribe, leave a like. And again, of course, leave a comment. You know, that's going to be definitely a major function. If you guys leave comments, we'll definitely address them. You know, you guys have any comments, questions, concerns, want to see us to react to anything, definitely leave it down below. So other than that, again, signing off. Thank you guys for listening. See you guys next week.